Hello and welcome to session 224 in the AISafety.com reading group. Tonight we'll be discussing a conversation that Robert Long had with Ernie Davis almost 2 years ago. So even though it's called Conversation with Ernie Davis, we don't have Ernie Davis here right now. So Ernie Davis is a professor of computer science at New York University, and he was interviewed by Robert Long from AI Impacts. That's where he says he's from, but actually AI Impact doesn't list him as people working there. Instead, he's actually a PhD student in philosophy at New York University. So this is the transcript. We don't have the audio, but there wasn't anything unclear in this, so I don't think that matters. And it was held in 2019, August, so that's almost 2 years ago. And of course, it's a bit bad that we haven't gotten around to discuss this yet. But the advantage of this is that some of the prediction that Ernest Davis makes, we can, in fact, evaluate them at least somewhat afterwards. This transcript and discussion references very heavily some work that Ernest Davis made just 2 months after the publication of Superintelligence. And we'll get into that later. And I should say this one in particular we discussed in the AISafety.com reading group in session 24, so 200 sessions ago. So this is partly a rerun, and I hope you will forgive us for that. So first, I would like to say thank you to Ernest Davis for critically examining the arguments for AI safety. I think this is really important, and not enough people do that, and we should try really to look into the arguments and learn as much as possible as we can from them. Also, I need some kind of apology in advance, because a number of the qualifiers that are set during the interview, I've had to strip them away. And I've also reordered everything by subject instead of the order that it appears in the transcript. So it's certainly possible I've made some errors there. If I should say something, then I think it would be nice to have a more formal reply, not just so Bostrom wrote Superintelligence, Ernest Davis answered, and Miri made a counter argument to Ernest Davis's argument all the way back in 2014. And I would have preferred to see a formal answer to Miri's answer. So on the odd chance that Ernest Davis ever hear this, then I think it's better to reply to Miri's comments rather than to mine, even though I, of course, believe that my answer is more relevant. With that out of the way, let's look at what Ernest Davis is actually saying. There are four parts. The first is that AI safety might not be so difficult that, in fact, simple solutions might suffice. The second part is about if we will have an ethical superintelligence and whether that will in fact turn out to be a good idea. The third part, point of disagreement, is to what extent you get power from having intelligence. And the fourth is whether there are more urgent priorities than AI safety. So let's start with the simple solutions proposed by Ernest Davis. So if we go back to the beginning of AI, there was the Dartmouth conference back in the 50s, where a lot of people were extremely optimistic about AI, about what they could, that they could basically do everything that humans could do. And you had things like spatial reasoning, you know, that's just three coordinates, X, Y, Z. How difficult can that be, really? And in fact, it turned out to be really, really difficult to give AIs the ability to reason spatially. Moravec's paradox is perhaps the most succinct statement of this. And this is indeed something that Ernest Davis knows very, very, very well. He is studying representation of common sense knowledge. And from that is there's a really, really clear intuition that just because something is easy, common sense for humans, that doesn't mean that when you try to actually formalize it, that it's in any way easy. The problem is that Ernest Davis gives some oddly similar arguments against AI safety. For instance, adding a stop button to an AI. That says, he describes this as a really easy problem, but he doesn't give any details. He doesn't formalize it, but he's just relying on some intuitions in the same way as people who argue for common sense knowledge were just looking at intuition rather than trying to formalize it. In a similar way, giving an AI a moral sense, well, that sounds quite doable in Ernest Davis' estimate. And to me, this seems to very much mirror the kind of optimism that was present in the Dartmouth conference. And I believe that it fails for the same reason, that when you try to make both common sense and these kind of solutions then it fails. So let's look at Ernest Davis' actual proposals for AI safety. So this comes from his papers with the reply Ethical Superintelligence to Bostrom's paper, to Bostrom's book Superintelligence. So this is a direct specification suggestion, and Bostrom in the book Superintelligence writes the following, among many other things, about direct specification. Nick Bostrom points out two problems. The first is, well, what values are you actually going to point to? And the second is, how do you transfer these values into something that computers can understand? How can you actually make this precise? And in the book Superintelligence, Nick Bostrom quotes Bertrand Russell on, everything is vague to a degree you do not realize till you have tried to make it precise. So this is what Bostrom says is the problem with direct specification. And yet, Ernest Davis has the following solution to direct specification. You specify a collection of admirable people, now dead, and then you instruct the AI to don't do anything that these people would have mostly seriously disapproved of. And to me, this is the problem when you try to make this precise, then there's a million ways it could fail. I tried to look up who the most admirable people were, and Xi Jinping was one of them, Vladimir Putin also, the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. These three people certainly are admirable by a majority of the human population, and I don't think this was what Ernest Davis was actually thinking about, but the problem is that he is in fact not specifying this. And also in his description, he doesn't relate this suggestion at all to what Nick Bostrom is saying would be the problem with this kind of suggestion. I think even it's quite clear from Superintelligence that Nick Bostrom have considered a number of very, very similar suggestions to this and discarded them. In a similar way, for the off switch, Ernest Davis claimed that we can just make an off switch that the robot cannot block. This is at least easy for robots. And this is somewhat of a problem in that he's only talking about robots. And in general, when we talk about artificial intelligence, we talk about computer programs. And talking about robots, it's called AI safety and not robot safety. And there's a good reason for this, because robots give a lot of wrong intuitions. We are not really worried about robots. And the suggestion is to just put a device somewhere inside that can cut off the power. And this can be done in a way so the robot cannot stop this, prevent this from happening, or even know the details about it. And once you start to think about how you would actually do this in practice, I'm sure that you would come up with a huge number of problems. That means that formalizing this solution is actually really, really hard. In particular, if you have super intelligence and you put some code as corresponding to a stop button into it, and then you ask the super intelligence to recursively improve itself, improve its source code, then it's very likely that it will be able to find some way to disable this stop button. The second part is about whether a super intelligence will be ethical. And there were quite a few ad hominems here from Ernest Davis that I have removed. So first he described solutions put forth by Elias Jutkowski, Nick Bostrom, and Stuart Russell. And say, and Ernest Davis summarizes them as saying that a superintelligence, if well designed, can be designed in such a way that it will evolve towards a superior ethical sense. But the problem with this is this superior ethical sense might just want to destroy all humans, and it's not very easy to do. And I think here it's possible that he just hasn't read very much that these people have written, because this is certainly not what they suggest. In general, the overall term that is searched for in AI safety is alignment rather than super ethical superintelligences. And this is quite a different problem, and this is in particular one that does not have this problem. Ernest Davis has a different idea. We give the AI a minimal moral sense, and it needs to understand just enough of ethics so it doesn't do some really stupid and evil things. And if we want to build a powerful intelligence, then it needs to have common sense. And if it has common sense, then it will realize that there's no point in turning the entire world into paperclips. And of course, this is also claimed to be easy, or quite doable at least. And I think in particular, this point that the AI will make realize that there's no point in turning the world into paperclips is something that is argued extensively in the book Superintelligence and many other places, that this is actually not the real issue. And I think the AI will certainly know that this is not what the intention was, but it will do it anyway. It seems like a really basic misunderstanding of AI safety. And I think if I should characterize this, it might be called an intelligent reply from someone who hasn't actually read the book Superintelligence, because this is a core part of the AI safety arguments that appears to be just plainly misunderstood. The third part is whether you will, if you are more intelligent, be able to obtain more power, more control. So first, one thing here in the interview that I was not super happy about was Robert Long, who performed the interview. He did not push back very much on the wrong things that Ernest Davis said. In particular, he admits that he is not very familiar with the arguments for AI safety. And I feel that was kind of sad and diminished the value of this interview. I know Katja Grace is working for AI Impacts, and we've read some of her work previously, and she is very familiar with the arguments for AI safety. So I think that would have been better. So in the Power for Intelligence we talk somewhat around the subject. So is there a relationship between more intellectual capacity and physical power and control over the world? Well, the argument that's used by Ernest Davis is that before we had humans, the brain size kind of seemed to go up, but there wasn't really a spectacular gain in power. So first I would say that there certainly was a correlation between brain size and evolutionary fitness in that, there are a few worms that don't have a central nervous system, but basically all the more human-centric a point of view you have, the more it is clear that organisms with larger brains are more successful, have more power in the world. But this is in a very anthropocentric world model. And this is not particularly interesting in our point of view, how it looked tens of millions of years ago before humans. We are much more interested in what is likely going to happen in the near future, what challenges are going to be relevant there. And what challenges will be relevant in the future? Well, the Elias Jutkowski and other people in AI safety have, according to Ernest Davis, an unrealistic view of how weird and difficult things will be after we have superintelligence. And that's certainly possible and might be a failure of imagination of some part, for me at least, because when I think about what would it mean to have superintelligence, strong superintelligence, so that we don't, our intellectual work is just superseded, turns into very, very weird scenarios in my view. I can't see business as usual after superintelligence in any kind of way. And then if you take a 2019 genius and put him into a Paleolithic village, they can kill him no matter how intelligent he is and how much he knows and so on. So my true objection to this is that this is not a central example of what will be the challenges of the 21st century. I think the future is likely to be one where intelligence matters way more, just like we are seeing it matter way more now compared to Neolithic period. It also probably matters more now. And in particular, this scenario is kind of a fragile scenario in that, for instance, there are many ways where the 2019 genius would in fact be able to thrive. For instance, if like we're building AIs for advice or help or something like that, and if the people in the Neolithic village start out friendly with this genius, then probably he will be able to obtain quite a lot of power. And also, just there's a failure of imagination here in that I believe, indeed, if you took a 2019 genius in a Neolithic village, you know, he might have good odds, depending on how strongly you want to interpret this. And finally, the fourth part is whether there are more urgent priorities. So the first is about when you build AIs, it's possible to have AIs fail in potentially dangerous ways just because you didn't do your AI part well enough. It's just incompetent in some way. And that's certainly true. And Ernest Davis states that this is going to be a big problem. So we are now sitting here almost two years after, and I think it's safe to say that it has in fact turned out to be a tiny problem, at least for these for the past 2 years. Whether it will continue to be a small problem is an open question, but I definitely think with regards to urgency, it was not urgent in August of 2019 to avoid, you know, self-driving cars killing people or something like that. So what you want to do AI safety is basically to do the standard engineering thing. And you also want to avoid embedding the AI in situations where you can't turn it off. And that's something that AI safety talks about. But unfortunately, the examples that are given by Ernest Davis is controlling the power grid and giving an AI access to ability to launch nuclear weapons and things like that. And that's not really what we're thinking about in AI safety. We're more thinking about things like Moloch, the ability that suddenly, in order to compete, if we won't be able to compete if we turn off the AI or doesn't give it as much power as possible. Ernest Davis is also very worried about malicious use of artificial intelligence. He leads with the anti-rationalist shibboleth that it always surprises me how many people are malicious in the world. And he believes that we might see malicious actors doing things like making AI that is hard to turn off, or robots that are able to reproduce itself cheaply. Again, talking about robots is really, really not the important thing. Which it would be so much more interesting if we talked about AIs, which are computer programs which can reproduce themselves easily, or somewhat easily, right? Computer programs are much more copyable than robots. He also talked about building AI that might be conscious. And here I've made an implied quote, because this is actually spliced things together from two things that are two paragraphs apart. But I think Ernest Davis believes that AI safety means worrying about things like self-replicating robots and conscious AI. And this is just not what we're talking about. This is not what is in the book Superintelligence, or what Stuart Russell or Elias Rutkowski talk about. So this is just plain wrong. A number of other more urgent problems are mentioned: cybercrime, cyberterrorism, the insecurity of the Internet of Things, and fake news. So I think it's instructive to compare August 2019 with May 2021. Have these problems, in fact, that were deemed to be more urgent, have they been problems? And I think it's fair to say that we haven't really done a lot on any of these. We've done a little, and something has been done, but I think it is also fair to say that nothing really bad has happened. I mean, you could argue with Donald Trump and fake news. I think it's certainly possible to argue something, but that was mostly before August 2019, I'd say. I would probably rate these predictions as falsified, but I think you could argue both ways. But one other thing that he also argues is that AIs will have a hard time knowing if it's possible to fold a watermelon. So I got Robert to ask GPT-3 if it's possible to fold a watermelon, and it mostly said it either said yes or gave strange answers, and sometimes said no. So I think Ernest Davis made a correct prediction at this point, and I believe this is indicative of a much more common pattern, that if there is an expert and you ask the expert to make some kind of prediction within the domain that the expert is an expert in, then he will give good predictions. Whereas if you ask the expert for predictions outside of his specialty, his subject, then he will both give poor predictions, and the expert will tend to be overconfident in these poor predictions. And I think that's likely what has happened here. That is all for today. Thank you, and see you next week.